Matt Caspi. I'm the director of the Taskar Center for Accessible Technology here at the University of Washington Computer Science and Engineering. The center is now a two-year-old effort, both to integrate a lot of universal design aspects to our undergraduate education, as well as involve our surrounding communities and outreach in the research that we do, specifically with a bent on addressing the needs of people with disabilities, mobility impairments, and speech impairments in particular. I'm very overjoyed to present to you Pieter Abbeel, the director of the Robot Learning Lab at UC Berkeley, and a good friend of myself and Ben Taskar. One of the most memorable moments I had with Pieter was visiting his home in Antwerp and attempting to do good by washing the dishes after dinner and being aware that I was contextually and situationally insensitive by not adapting to the environment that I was in, specifically understanding the constraints of water usage in Antwerp. And to me, this is very relevant to the kind of robot learning work that Pieter does, in the sense that we can teach robots how to do certain things, but then we would like them to adapt to situational constraints that are important. And those constraints might be heterogeneous, especially in the situations that have to do with people with disabilities, where different people have very different needs, and those adaptations are paramount. Dr. Pieter Abbeel is doing striking advances in robot learning and deep reinforcement learning, and the implications of those are likely to have great impact on assistive technologies, the way we teach, behave, and are assisted by robotic technologies. Without further ado, I'd like to bring Pieter to the fore. Thank you.
Thank you, Anand. Thanks, everybody, for having me here. It's a great pleasure to be at the University of Washington, especially for the Ben Taskar Memorial Lecture. And so what I first want to do is say a little bit about how I got to know Ben. So actually, I was starting out as a master's student at Stanford, very eager to try to get involved in research. But research is not really for master's students, only for PhD students. And there's like hundreds of master's students, and only a few of them get to do research. But sure enough, Ben took me under his wing in Daphne Koller's group and really got me going on research. In my first two papers were with Ben, and he taught me a lot about how research is done, how to choose new problems, how to try to solve them. And I also want to highlight some of the things. So one of the papers you probably, of many of you know, is the Max Margin Planning paper, NIPS paper that unified optimization-based approaches and graphical models for structured prediction. But I think what was also really interesting at the time, this is 2004, actually, Ben was trying to think about end-to-end training, fully end-to-end training in the context of the time, which was you train a graphical model, you run belief propagation, but belief propagation is approximate. So he was actually trying to set up models where you would, at training time, put the belief propagation inside the graphical model, set up an end-to-end computation graph, and try to optimize it. The tools didn't really exist at the time to easily do this. There was no Theano, no TensorFlow. But I think it's very intriguing that what 10 years ago Ben was trying to do is actually what most of us, or many of us, are actually doing right now, this fully end-to-end computation graph formulations. Aside from working with Ben, he was also a really good friend, super kind, super smart, couldn't have wished for any better mentor or friend, and I'm really honored that you invited me to present for this lecture here. Thank you. All right, so a lot of what I've been working on recently is reinforcement learning. And just to give a little bit of context for people who might not be working in reinforcement learning themselves, in reinforcement learning, there's a notion of a robot and an environment. And the robot and environment are in some state. You might observe it. You might just have a picture of it. That observation then goes to your control policy, which is controlled by your agent. Your agent takes an action based on that control policy. The control policy could be a deep neural net, could be something else, whatever you want to put in there. For this talk, it'll usually be a deep neural net. The deep neural net spits out an action or a distribution over actions. This changes the world, changes the robot, and this process repeats. And so you have a temporal process over time where the world and the robot evolve due to the robot's actions, but also stochasticity and dynamics of the environment. The supervision is not at an per action level, but the supervision is given by a reward function. The designer says, these are the things you want, I want to achieve, and you give them high scores, high reward. For example, if you want a robot to cook a good meal, then maybe you give a 5-star, 5 points for a meal you really enjoyed when it gets brought to you, 4 for a not so good, and then 0 maybe for a really bad one. You can imagine that this is quite challenging because if you might cook for half an hour and then only after half an hour get just one number back, you have a very sparse signal to learn from. This is a lot of applications outside of robotics too, though. It's not just for robotics. Anything where you have a decision your system makes, and then the system will deal with the consequences of its actions, and this repeats over time. This could be robotics, could be marketing and advertising, dialogue management, logistics operations, power management, HVAC management, and so forth. In contrast to supervised learning, I would say these are the three big challenges that reinforcement learning has that supervised learning doesn't have nearly as much or not at all. First one is stability. Because you have a feedback loop, you're learning while you're acting in that feedback loop. You might destabilize the system, destroy the system before you've actually learned something. Whereas in supervised learning, somebody just gives you the data to learn from. Credit assignment. If a robot cooks a meal for a half hour and then you give it a score back, now it needs to allocate that score to the past half hour activity and decide what was good, what was bad in that half hour of activity. That's a very hard problem. That's the credit assignment problem. Other examples, imagine you're driving a car and you have a flat tire at some point. As a human, you might say, oh, I remember I drove over the broken glass on the road, maybe that was it. And that's you doing credit assignment, saying in the future I should probably not drive over broken glass. But it's not that simple for an AI system to figure out that over a long period of interaction, that might have been the salient event that caused this failure. Exploration is the challenge of finding things you've never done before and finding out how good or how bad they are. Sometimes they'll be bad, but until you try, you might not know. And so these three challenges make reinforcement learning a lot harder than supervised learning. Despite these extra challenges, there actually have been quite a few successes, especially in the past few years. So one many of you might be familiar with are the successes on Atari, initially achieved at DeepMind, but then other groups at Michigan, Berkeley, and again DeepMind rivaled those successes or even extended them. And what happened here is a deep neural net was trained to take in raw image pixels, process those raw image pixels, and output a choice of action, a choice of joystick action. So from low-level vision pixels all the way to low-level actions. And over a long period of training time, that neural net was trained to get a good set of weights that performs well at solving these tasks, actually many of them better than human-level performance. It doesn't just work for games. What you see here is the Mujoko simulator built by Emo Todorov and collaborators here at the University of Washington. And what you see here is a simulated robot learning locomotion. A neural net is mapping from joint angles, joint velocities, coordinates of the center of mass of that robot, to torques at each of the motors. Initially, the neural net is initialized with random weights. There's 100,000 of those weights, so it does something pretty arbitrary. And at iteration 0, you saw it fall over. But by acting for a while, looking at that data, then updating the weights and repeating with every iteration, improving the weights and hence improving performance, you can see after 2,000 iterations, it's able to invent locomotion. The reward here was as simple as the further north, the better, the less impact with the ground, the better, and the lower torques, the better. So this is a very simple reward that does not specify what walking or running looks like. It is to invent that as a solution to try to optimize reward. You can then swap out the simulator for another one. It's still Mujoko, but you put in a different model, in this case, a spider-like robot, and can run the exact same algorithm without change. This is thrust vision policy optimization with generalized advantage estimation. And it can be trained to now control this robot. So the beauty here is that you design one algorithm, it's applicable to a wide range of tasks. Here, another task. Here, the reward function is the distance of the head to standing head height. There's nothing in there about motions that might be needed to get up, but as it gets the head higher, it understands that some actions must have been good because the reward is related to getting the head higher up, and ultimately it invents a way to get up. It also works on real robots. So what you see here is guided policy search, invented by Sergey Levin and collaborators. And what you see here is a robot learning from scratch to place a block onto the target spot in that corner. This is a very hard task. Compare this to a human inserting a key into a keyhole. It's not just enough to roughly know where the target is. You actually also need to feel it out and push in the right directions to get this in place. To give you a little bit of an idea of how long this takes, the learning locomotion, if it were done in real time, takes about 2 weeks of real time. Of course, simulators are fast, so you can parallelize them, but if you had one robot you're running in real time, it would be 2 weeks. Probably your hyperparameters would be wrong and it wouldn't work. You would have to go again, but that's just to give you a picture of how long it roughly takes. This ends up being quite a bit faster. You can see that there's a resetting motion here, which helps a lot in speeding up the learning. This can learn in about an hour. And then, of course, is a big success from DeepMind with AlphaGo, learning to play Go better than the best human player, and even getting better now on the internet contest that they're playing. So there's a lot of success here. And you might say, well, are we done? I would argue we're far from done. I think there are two very big challenges, and I'll say a few more other challenges later, but that I want to talk about here, sample complexity and safety. This takes a long time to learn these skills, and there's no safety guarantees during any of the learning here, which can be a real problem in practical situations. For sample complexity, I'm going to tell you about four steps we've been taking at improving sample complexity. This is by no means an exhaustive summary of what you can do, but just four new ideas that have come out recently. And then later, I'll talk a little bit about safety. OK, RL squared. So let's start from an observation here. What we're looking at here is the game of Pong. The goal is to make this ball go back and forth and shoot it behind the player on the other side, a bit like air hockey, but without a goal, just a whole wall of goal. Now, if you look at what a human can do, score of 9.3, DeepMind's DQN got a score of 18.9, so DeepMind's player is actually better than a typical human player. But if you actually dig a little deeper, DeepMind's player needed training for 40 days, and the human player was able to get to this performance in 2 hours. 2 hours is a lot faster, and I would argue that what we see on the left here is a form of slow learning, and on the right is fast learning, and we'd like to move our algorithms into the regime of fast learning rather than slow learning. Starting observation, algorithms that are our best RL algorithms to date, TRPO, DQN, A3C, they are fully general reinforcement learning algorithms. That is, for any Markov decision process, that is, any environment with a reward function and dynamics, anything that you can define mathematically, these algorithms are applicable, and equally so. They don't have any particularly strong preferences or assumptions about what environments they'll be faced with. If we look at Markov decision processes that we encounter in the real world, actually, it's a tiny, tiny subset of the ones that we can define mathematically. And so the question we're trying to answer is, can we design fast RL algorithms, where what we mean here is not RL algorithms that are fast for every problem in the world, every problem that you can mathematically define, but fast for the problems that will be encountered in the real world, because that's only a tiny subset of the full set of mathematically definable MDPs. So there are two questions here. First one is, how do you acquire a good prior for the real-world Markov decision processes that you might encounter? And then assuming you have such a prior, maybe by looking at games or maybe slightly more complicated environments, how do you design algorithms that make use of such a prior and learn more quickly? So if we can do this, then hopefully we end up with a fast RL algorithm instead of a slow one. There might be various ways of doing this. The way we've been looking at it is to look at a way of encoding both the algorithm that uses the prior and the prior all together in one big neural net that does everything for us in one go. So it's a fairly black box approach, but I'll tell you a little bit more about how we train this. So the formulation is somebody defines a distribution over relevant MDPs. Maybe somebody says there is a set of games that you could encounter, and games will be drawn from that distribution, and you can train on that subset of that distribution, familiarize yourself with what games look like, and then you'll get test games in the future, and you need to learn very quickly on those new games in the future that come from a similar distribution. So the way we'll represent the fast algorithm is by using a recurrent neural net. And don't get hung up too much on the fact that it's a recurrent neural net. Just think of it as generic computation that is parameterized with weights, and you can easily compute gradients through it and change what it computes. If the weights are different than the recurrent neural net, that means that the different reinforcement learning algorithm is encoded by that recurrent neural net. If you change the activations of the units, that means a different policy. So the recurrent neural net effectively stores the policy it's learned in the activations it has, and the weights of the net define the RL algorithm that's being run. Of course, we don't know what those weights are going to be. We're going to have to learn that. So what it looks like at training time is something like this. You start in the first MDP, MDP1, initial state. Your agent gets to choose an action. New state happens, reward happens, and this repeats till episode one ends. Your agent dies, or it's the end of the game or something. Then you get a new episode in that same MDP, act in that episode till it ends, and then maybe you go to the next MDP, and this repeats over time. So what's different here from standard reinforcement learning is that the MDP changes during training from one MDP to the next MDP. And the goal is to train something, train an agent that within one trial, what we call trial here, which contains multiple episodes, accumulates maximal reward. So if you think about it, a good agent would do something where in the early trials, the agent would explore, see what's available, and in later trials would exploit. If it knows that it's in a situation where there's always only two episodes, it might not explore a whole lot. If it knows that the situations where you get hundreds of episodes every time, it might do a lot of exploration and then exploitation at the end. Conceptually, what it means is that if you compare with standard reinforcement learning algorithms, if you had a standard slow algorithm, the slow algorithm would try to train a policy. The policy would take actions and get observations back, but the policy would just be doing this, and the reward would go to the algorithm. And the algorithm makes a decision on how to change the policy. Here what we have a recurrent neural net policy that lives inside the agent. It's dropped in a new MDP. It takes actions, but it also gets to see rewards. And based on reward, changes its activations, accordingly changes its policy, and can act differently at the next time. It doesn't need input from the slow algorithm to change its activations and change what it would do. Of course, the slow algorithm can still update the weights and does that over these trial periods. An alternative view of this is that we're actually running standard reinforcement learning. We're just calling it RL squared, or we're just calling it meta learning. We're actually running standard reinforcement learning, but we're running it in a partially observable Markov decision process. And what's partially observable about it is that we don't know which Markov decision process we're in. And so we don't know which MDP we're in. So that's why it's a PomDP all of a sudden. And a recurrent neural net is our policy and effectively figures out which MDP we're in, and then based on that can figure out how to act. So actually a lot of related work on learning to learn. In fact, 2016 is even more than it's on this slide, work on how to learn to optimize, how to learn supervised learning quickly from small amounts of data and so forth. The most closely related work is the top paper here, Learning to Reinforcement Learn. That's from DeepMind. And interestingly, done completely independently, they ran the exact same set of experiments that I'll tell you. So it's, I guess it was in the air to try to do this. First thing that paper and also has looked at is multi-armed bandits. Multi-armed bandits are a special setting for reinforcement learning. It's a very simple setting. Here you're faced with a bunch of bandits. Ahead of, they have You assume, otherwise it's not interesting, that each of them has a different probability of paying off money when you pull the arm. But you don't know which one might have the higher probability of payoff, which one might have the lower probability of payoff. So you have to pull the different arms, try to figure out which one's more promising, and pull that one more and more and more, and that's a good strategy. Since it's such a simple setting, people have been able to develop optimal algorithms that are, have guarantees to, in terms of maximizing expected payoff on expectation, given that ahead of time, you don't know which bandit is going to be the better one. And so the Bayes optimal one is the Gitness Index strategy, and there are simpler algorithms that get close to that, such as UCB1 and Thompson sampling. So what we did is we asked ourselves the question, can you run this learning to reinforcement learn, RL squared, can you run this, and then see how well it does compared to the Bayes optimal? We're not expected to outperform it. We just want to see, can we automatically invent an algorithm that's as good as one that has taken people a long time to invent in this setting? Here's a table of results. Gittens is Bayes optimal. Some subtleties there in terms of asymptotically Bayes optimal, but let's ignore that here. So it's indeed almost always the best one. But if you look at RL squared, the last column, it's equally good for short horizon or medium horizon problems, whereas in the very long horizon problems, it actually doesn't do as well as Gitlin's indices. Maybe it needs more data to train policies that can think over longer horizons. Learning curves, this is when you get to pull only 10 times, you get to pull 100 times, you get to pull 500 times. When you only pull 10 times, it turns out it's a very short horizon. Being Bayes optimal asymptotically is actually not optimal, and these learned approaches can actually outperform Gitlin's indices, which is the dashed horizontal line. At 100, it's about the same, and then at 500, they're not as good just yet. You can do the same thing for canonical MDPs, where you just have states, and you have generic transitions between them based on actions, and there are Bayes optimal approaches there based on model-based reinforcement learning. You can compare RL squared to those, and actually, it does quite comparable to the Bayes optimal approaches that exist in those small environments. And here is a comparison in terms of how long it takes as a function of the number of iterations, so the number of trials you need. We see that after roughly 1,000 trials for many of these, learning the algorithm is as good as the best human-designed algorithm so far. Of course, the interesting thing is what we can do when it's a situation that is more complex and humans cannot design the Bayes optimal algorithm. What can we do there? So let's consider navigation. This is the agent's view, raw pixels. Commands for the agents are velocity, forward velocity, and steering, so low-level motion commands. And the goal here is to find the destination, but the agent does not have a map. Agent is dropping the environment, does not have a map, gets to run around. When it reaches the destination, gets reward, gets reset to the initial state, and gets to go again. So the right strategy here would be something where you explore the maze in a clever way. Once you reach the destination, you get reset, you try to remember what you did, you, based on the internal map that you build for the maze, think about what the shortcuts are that you should have taken, that you didn't take the first time around because you didn't know the maze, and then follow the shortest path to the goal. So on the left here, what you see is what happens before learning. When there's no learning has happened, the recurrent neural net is just outputting actions and doesn't really know yet what to do. And it kind of bumps into the wall a lot and doesn't really get places too quickly. But after learning, on the right, here's what happens. First episode in a new environment. Second episode, it's able to find a shortcut and get to destination very quickly. So this is exactly what we would hope this algorithm would do. It doesn't do it always, but actually does it quite a lot in these medium-sized mazes. Here are the learning curves. Sometimes the learning is not succeeding. It's something to kind of keep in mind here. This meta-learning algorithm is a lot that has to be learned, and not every random initialization set of runs leads to a successful learned recurrent neural net policy, but about half of them do, and then it performs quite well. Next step here is to widen the set of environments to something like OpenAI Universe, where there is thousands of games, and see if we can train on a small set of games, well, maybe 800 games or something, and then quickly learn to play new games that the system has never played before. So that's a very black box approach. Another way to kind of reduce sample complexity is actually go exactly the opposite route, which is to build in algorithmic priors. So the idea behind value attrition networks is the following. If you, for example, want to navigate from a start location to a goal location, and in this case, we will have a map. So this is all given to the agent. How do you do that? The way you would do this is by running planning. The natural thing, you make a plan, see what sequence of actions would succeed, and get to the goal. Standard Q-learning or policy gradient methods with standard neural net architectures will actually not have the ability to plan. They don't have the computational resources to run planning. And so when you train them to try to solve these kinds of problems, they will generalize very poorly because internally they're not planning. They're doing pattern recognition, and they're failing on new situations unless you really make them face pretty much every situation they could possibly encounter. But you want generalization from a small set of examples. And so what you can do is actually build planning into these neural nets. So rather than saying, let's use a generic neural net, what you can do is say, well, our neural net has value iteration built in. Value iteration is a standard planning algorithm for Markov decision processes. What value iteration does is essentially compute some weighted sums, take some maxes. So these are very simple operations and does it many, many times. Those operations are laid out here in a computation graph. If you feed in a reward and a transition model, out will come the optimal value function. Then The abnormal value function you can use locally where you are with an attention model to decide what to do, take a good action, and repeat. The question, of course, is how do you make sure that this works? You need a good reward function, you need a good dynamics model. In practice, those are hard to obtain. And so what we look at here is end-to-end training where you say, I'm going to observe a human act in this environment, and I want to match their actions. So this is supervised learning in the simplest setting. I'm going to match their actions with the calculations this network makes. And so backpropagating through this network to match this training examples corresponds to essentially forcing this network to figure out a dynamics model and a reward function that are consistent with the human behavior and that then hopefully allow you to generalize in new situations. And value iteration itself underneath is essentially a recurrent neural net that has some convolutional layers or locally weighted sums and then a max operator. Okay. So what we have here is an end-to-end differentiable planner. We can directly optimize the planner. You can put in auxiliary losses if you want. If you have access to reward or data about the dynamics, you can put that in too. But in our work, we actually didn't do this. We just trained it end-to-end to match actions or to use it as a control policy architecture inside reinforcement learning. We can do this on grid wall navigation. We compared it with how well a convolutional neural net is able to match to learn from human demonstrations. The training error is lower for value iteration networks, and the test error is also quite a bit lower, actually, than we have for CNNs. So we see that this generalizes a lot better by fusing, by bringing in the prior information that planning matters for this problem. What we see on the right is a Mars surface picture. What we did there is once you have this kind of architecture, you don't need to feed in a map of the environment. What you feed in here could be just a picture. And then what happens is you're feeding in a picture into a computational box that expects state. So you're effectively forcing the neural net that lives between picture and that computational box, you're forcing that neural net to extract state because otherwise the next box won't be able to do the right thing and so you're able to learn from raw pixels to map to something that corresponds to state that then is used for planning. And it actually works quite well in these kind of overhead pictures as well as the simulated environments there. Here's a picture of the behavior in that environment. It doesn't exactly find the shortest path, but it finds good paths, and it's able to find them quite reliably in a wide range of environments. In recent work, in Jitendra Malik's group at Berkeley, they've extended this. And the way they've set it up is they've said, let's now take first-person vision, put it on a mobile robot, have a mobile robot go around in an office building, take in imagery, set up the neural net architecture such that that imagery has to be processed onto something that has the architecture of a map. That map architecture is fed into a value iteration network, which does planning on that map. And this is trained end-to-end. And so what you have happened there is that there's a lot of prior information in the system, prior information that the first-person imagery should be made into a map, that you should plan on that map, but this is then trained end-to-end without internal supervision, is able to learn to navigate pretty complex environments. So that's just some very closely related work by Martin Riedmiller and collaborators on embed the control. Very interesting what they did there. They said, we're going to force our control algorithm to be an LQR controller, and whatever observations we take in, by the neural net have to be mapped into an environment where LQR control is meaningful. And so same idea, LQR instead of value iteration works very well for control of continuous systems. Some recent work by Aviv Tamar is looking at using this within the context of model predictive control. Now she uses the same idea in estimation. In fact, some of the works by Dieter here at the University of Washington, you can think about what estimation means. What is happening in estimation? You might run a Kalman filter. You might run a particle filter. You might know that things like poses matter and how pose can be represented. You can force that to be present in your computation graph, but then in front of it put arbitrary neural net computation that then is forced to turn whatever pixels it's seeing into these meaningful entities that you know you're expecting that then are computed with in a way that you have a strong prior over objects need to move as rigid bodies and so forth to then get out good estimates of what is happening in the world. Another direction that promises reducing sample complexity is unsupervised learning. The idea in unsupervised learning is that Supervised learning is great when you have labels. You can learn the pattern. But getting labels can be expensive. And is there any way to speed it up in a way that doesn't require explicit labeling? So a lot of work in unsupervised learning, probably the leading approaches right now are largely generative-based. There is generative adversarial networks, which I'll talk about here. There's also variational autoencoders, which build likelihood models for your data, and pixel CNN type models, and more generally, autoregressive models that build other types of likelihood models for your data. And the notion here is that if you are able to model your data, if you're able to generate your data, it means whatever you built there understands something about the world. And then if you can leverage whatever is inside that something you build, maybe you can learn more quickly for other tasks. Now, what does a GAN look like, the one we've been looking at? So a generative adversarial network takes in noise. Noise gets fed into a generated neural net, which could be some arbitrary neural net. That will generate a picture in this case. That picture gets fed into a discriminator neural net that then has to decide whether this is a picture that was generated artificially, then, well, a real picture that comes from a data set of real pictures. Sometimes, of course, it's being fed in X, some real data. It doesn't know what's being fed into it. It needs to learn to make that decision. So you're playing a game here. The discriminator is trying to distinguish real from fake, and the generator is playing against that, trying to fool it. And when this converges, if it converges, the generator is generating images that look like real images, and the discriminator has a 50-50 chance of getting it right because everything looks like real images. And so this is what it looks like in terms of optimization. You're optimizing the log probability of the real data and then the counter-objective for images that were generated. This was developed a few years ago by Ian Goodfellow at the University of Montreal. Recently, Alec Radford extended the architectures used inside this to get really realistic images. This was a little further extended after that. And so what you see here on the left is the real images, on the right, generated images. And these generated images are starting to look a lot like real images. If you look carefully, they're not real images, but they're starting to look a lot like it. And the question now is, can we do something meaningful with this? We now have a process to generate images. How do we get out information that we can use for learning? Because this code that lives at the bottom is just random noise. It might not have a lot of information for us. So we've proposed a small change to GAN called InfoGAN. This is the standard GAN. On the right is InfoGAN. If you look at it, what's different? Instead of just Z, there's also a C, a code. You might say that's just an extension of Z. That's fine to think of it as that so far. If it was nothing else, it would be like an extension of Z. But then at the top, there's an extra discriminator that's trying to distinguish which code was being fed into this. The intuition here being that we want to be able to recover what code we used to generate the image. If we can do that, that means the code is more likely to be something meaningful rather than just something arbitrary. And so concretely, if you set it up this way with the extra discriminator to try to recover part of the code, you can do this, for example, for MNIST. Here we have three code variables. One is categorical, and two are uniform. Here's the categorical one. When you change it, you cycle through the categorical one. Cycling through the categorical one shows you that it effectively corresponds to the digits. It's not perfect. Among the nines, there is a 7, and this is representative of how good this is. Essentially, among the 50 digits that I'm showing, one of them is off. That's about the kind of level of accuracy it attains, but this is without any supervision. This is just giving it data, and it happens to put in that particular node the meaning of what digit you're looking at. For the uniform ones, one of them, they both correspond to reshaping the digit. And so also, if you look at horizontal axis, when you keep Z fixed, that's what corresponds to a row. If you change the code variables, you get different columns or different animations here. So this is really interesting. What we see here is that rather than having just a random code, we're able to recover meaningful representations of what the natural variation is in these types of images. You can do the same thing for faces. It's actually some prior work that did this out of MIT. But the big difference with the prior work is that the prior work relied on aligned data sets. It relied on knowing that here's an image of the same face from many different viewpoints and was able to use that extra information to recover structuring the data. What I'm showing you, there's no information being fed in. It's just a bag of digits, or in this case, a bag of faces with no relationship between the faces that are fed in at different times, or at least no knowledge of that to the algorithm. You can see that without the supervision, with InfoGAN, you can get the same kind of meaningful variables changing viewpoint as you vary variable, one of the code variables. You can do the same thing with chairs. You vary the noise, that's vertical variation. You vary the code variable, you get a different pose onto the same chair. You can do the same thing with the size of the chair, left to right, size is changing here. You can do this with emotions, left to right, the emotion is changing. We didn't choose emotion. We looked at what happens when you change the categorical variable, and we noticed this seems to correspond to emotion, more or less smiling. You can do the same thing with viewpoint, and you can do the same thing with presence or absence of glasses. It doesn't always work, but you can see a trend here where as the variable C3 is changed, you have people without glasses on the left with darker and darker glasses towards the right. Again, without any supervision about this. So what's going on here is that InfoGAN encourages the code to have meaningful information that is transmitted through the image. And the intuition here is that if you did something very naive, like you're going to encode what's in your code by just encoding it directly into a pixel, the discriminator that's trying to say whether your image is real or not will right away notice this is not a real image. Because if you just directly put your code into a pixel, that pixel will have weird statistics relative to the other pixels in the image, and it's easy to single that out. So you need to find natural variation in images to encode what's in your code. And that's what we observe here that's happening. Another part of it that's interesting to keep in mind is that it also relates to which architecture you use. The invariants that are captured relate to shift invariants, for example, and other invariants that are built into compnets. All right. Another way to reduce sample complexity is to start with demonstrations. In fact, a lot of reinforcement learning success in robotics has been by first demonstrating and learning from those demonstrations, followed by fine-tuning with reinforcement learning. Why? It takes away the exploration challenge. Exploration is very hard. Running into a success is very difficult to do. But if you demonstrate, you know what the successes look like, and now all you need to do is fine-tune. So there's been a lot of work along those lines. The direction we've been pushing here is third-person imitation learning. Let me contrast that with first-person. In first-person imitation learning, the demonstration is with the robot itself. So you might drive a car, and the car experiences how it's driven, the way you experience yourself how you're driving the car. You might teleoperate a robot. You might kinesthetically teach a robot how to go through something, and so forth. In this case, demonstrations and autonomous mode are extremely similar. The robot is in the same situation. In third-person imitation learning, the goal is for the robot to watch something. Let's say watch a YouTube video or watch somebody in their house demonstrate what should be done and learn from that. If the robot were then to execute, it will never look the same to the robot when the robot does it. The robot does not have a human arm. The robot has a different arm, so it's never going to actually match up. The view will be very different. The robot will have a first-person view, whereas we'll look externally onto the person who's demonstrating. So the question is how to deal with this big discrepancy. This is hard. We started with some simple problems. So what you see here is on the top row, the third-person view. This is the view from which the robot gets to observe demonstrations. And then the bottom row is how the robot will see it when executing themselves. And what the robot has to understand is what was seen executed in the top row type situation. What does that mean for the robot, what it has to do in the bottom row type situation? Our starting point is something called GAIL, Generative Adversarial Imitation Learning, which was simultaneously put forward by Jonathan Ho at Stanford and Chelsea Finn at Berkeley. And the idea here is that the reward is defined by a learned classifier. So you're saying, when I observe a demonstration, it's implicitly encoding a reward function. And my goal is to first recover the reward function encoded by that behavior and then optimize against that reward function. Okay? And the way it was set up, they wanted to learn a deep neural net that can encode this reward function. And the way they set it up, they said, if we have behaviors that are expert and non-expert, we can train a discriminator between those two behaviors. The discriminator will maybe output 1 for expert, 0 for non-expert. You can take the log of that signal and consider that your reward. And so you say the log of the probability of it being expert is the reward, and then you optimize against that when you're autonomously executing. This works very well for first-person imitation learning. can train a deep net, distinguish between what the expert did and what the robot is trying, and the robot will do something different, so it'll learn that actually it's not that great and it's better to be more like the expert, and over time the robot will get closer and closer to doing what the expert did. In third-person setting, this doesn't work. It'll be very easy to distinguish between the human demonstration and the robot. It'll be a completely different viewpoint. There'll be human skin versus robot skin, and so it's completely trivial, and the robot will never be able to optimize the log probability of looking like the expert. It'll just be stuck. Solution we've been looking at is based on domain confusion. The idea here is that rather than feeding raw images into this classifier that's classifying expert versus non-expert, you feed it through a bottleneck, a feature representation that tries to be invariant to viewpoint. The way you do this is by saying this feature representation has to be such that if all you get to see is this feature representation, it's impossible to understand whether you have the third-person viewpoint than well the first-person viewpoint. If you do that, you've erased that easy way of distinguishing expert from non-expert, and hopefully, of course, enough information would be retained to still learn about what expert behavior looks like. That's actually pretty tricky, because once you have this objective here, you can distinguish third from first-person view, you might lose the distinction between expert and non-expert completely. Nothing is left. And so to be able to deal with this, we let this objective only process one image at a time. And so based on a single image, you're not supposed to be able to understand expert versus third versus first person point of view. But if you see a stream of images represented among in those features, you're still allowed to understand where it came from. Then you're looking at the behavior over time, and that encodes the reward that you care about, the behavior that you care about. What this fully looks like is you get an image input, another image input, you get two, extract features. Those features get fed into a classifier that tries to distinguish between first person and third person. You try to fold this classifier. That means your features are somewhat restricted in terms of what they can express. The classifier only gets to see one frame. You get these domain invariant features over there. Then you get that for multiple time steps. The multiple time step domain invariant features get fed into the discriminator between expert behavior and non-expert behavior. The log of that is used as the reward function in your reinforcement learning algorithm, and that is also optimized to continue to try to distinguish between what the robot is doing and what the expert did. Once you put it all together, this actually works reasonably well. So what you see here are some learning curves. It's a function of the number of iterations in the algorithm, how well the robot is doing in its first-person view, trying to imitate what it's seen from a third-person point of view. This is the reacher on the left, inverted pendulum in the middle, and point rewards on the right. Then what we see here is the domain confusion. What we want to see here is 0.5. We want to see that the features that are being used are not enough to understand whether you're looking from a first-person or a third-person point of view when you only get a single frame. And indeed, that is happening here. So that's a good sign. Here's what it looks like. So here's the reacher. This is the demonstration video. And then on the right, this is the robot. Initially, it's not so great. It's still learning. It's both figuring out its policy and the reward function should be optimizing. But over time, it figures out what to do. You can see that the visuals on the right are very, very different from the visuals on the left, but it's able to extract the essence between the two and based on that learn what it means to do the right thing and do quite well on reaching to the red ball here. Okay, those are the things I wanted to highlight for sample complexity. In the last little part here, I want to say a little bit about safety. Safety is really important when you work with robots. If you do autonomous driving, if robots interacting with people, robots manipulating fragile objects, maybe a fragile robot that can damage itself. During reinforcement learning, if you do it naively, it's pretty much guaranteed that the robot will break something and do irreparable damage. So you need to be aware of what could go wrong and somehow prevent it during learning. So the goal here is that we would like to learn a control policy that maps from raw observations to controls without killing the robot along the way or killing something else along the way. So we have an observation, a policy, and output would be controls. The example we'll be looking at is autonomous flight and autonomous driving. Okay? And we want the policy to go from raw pixels to raw controls, so likely it's going to be a deep neural net. That's the best available right now. The requirement remains that we want this to be safe, meaning if it's, let's say, a quadcopter, we don't want the quadcopter to fly hard into a wall and be damaged and then not be able to continue learning because it's damaged. We don't know the environment, and so the question is, how do we learn in an environment we don't know? We don't want to instrument it either. So there are tricks you can play if you put it in a mocap system and so forth. We don't want to do any of that. We want a quad that can go out in the real world without any instrumentation and just say, go, learn to fly, learn to avoid obstacles, and that's it. Okay, so the cost we care about will consist of two parts. There's a task cost, reaching a destination or go as far north as possible or something like that. And then there is a collision cost. And the collision cost might depend on how fast you go during collision. If you go very fast, collision cost is super high, it's terrible. If you're going slow, then a collision is maybe not that bad. You might be able to recover from it. What we're going to do is learn a model that maps from current situation and controls that we're about to apply in the next capital H time steps to whether there will be a collision or not. So probability of collision within the next capital H time steps, given the current image that we're seeing and the controls we plan to apply. Then, of course, if we have that model, we can search over different sequences of controls, find a sequence of controls that avoids a high probability of collision, execute that, and then repeat. So observation here is raw image, and we command the velocities of the quad. And the model itself will be a neural net. OK, so this is a model-based approach. We're trying to build a model for what will happen, and then plan in that model, execute. So what happens, we have some data initially. From that data, we train some collision prediction model. This will be a deep neural net. I'll say a little more about how exactly we train it. Then, after this has been trained, we don't just train a prediction of probability of collision, we also train it to output uncertainty about its prediction. Because often it will have no idea what it's looking at, and it will not be able to output anything reliable. So we want it to not just output what's likely of prediction, but also how certain am I about this likelihood. It'll use that, combine it with collision cost, to decide on what is a good sequence of controls to apply. If probability of collision is high, in all directions, it will have to choose a sequence of controls that makes it fly very, very slow, so that collision has no bad repercussions. If it can fly without collision, then it should fly fast to explore more of the world more quickly. Then it collects that data, has a new data set, and improves the model. It might have experienced collision, might not have. Either way, that supervision about what happened in those situations and repeats. As the robot gets more and more data, the models will become more and more confident, and the robot can fly faster and faster. Here's what the collision cost looks like. We'll look at speed, because higher speed collisions are worse, times the expectation of being in collision, plus a standard deviation or variance term. So if we are uncertain about whether we'll collide or not, we want to play it safe and fly slowly. And that's what that extra term is doing. Okay? So high speed means large cost if we collide, predict collision. If we think there's a high probability of collision, that's large cost. If we have large uncertainty, that's another reason to go slow. The way to get uncertainty estimates is we do it in two ways. One is bootstrapping. Bootstrapping during training time, what you do is you have your data. You don't use it just once. You resample with replacement from your data, train multiple networks, and then at test time, you compare their predictions. They predict different things, and you then look at the mean and the standard deviation of their prediction and use that to know your uncertainty about your predictions. You can also do dropout, which some argue is like bootstrapping, but it's not exactly the same. At training time, you train multiple models, but the only thing that changes here when you train is that you drop out different edges in your model. And at test time, you do the same thing. You compute with different edges being dropped out at random from your neural net. Of course, there's hundreds of thousands of edges here, and then a reasonable fraction is dropped out, not just one. And this gives you uncertainty estimates, too. OK, when you do this, let's look at a video. So what we see here is the training. This is the quad. This starts from scratch. These are the four starting locations. From each one of them, it'll start five times. We won't actually let the quad collide. The human operator will press stop when it's about to collide, and that stop signal will be interpreted as a collision. And we use that as a surrogate signal for collision because our quad is not super robust and we didn't want to lose it. So what you see here is the training in action. The graphs on the top show a histogram of the speed at which collision happened. On the left, uncertainty of the neural net is ignored in making the decisions. And we see a lot of the histogram is at the end. We see a lot of high-speed collisions happen, meaning that a lot of collisions happened when the neural net thought there would be no collision, and it went fast and collided. But on the right, thanks to bootstrapping and dropout, it understands that it didn't know. And in the there's two separate trainings happening. And in our version of the training, this high-speed collision is very unlikely to happen because the neural net understands that danger and would slow the quad down. And the collisions happen at slower speed or don't happen at all. Here's a comparison of the final histograms. You see on the left, the tall entry here. That's bad. That means you have a lot of high-speed collisions. This is our approach. After the last rollout, after the training, you see just based on raw pixels, it knows how to navigate around this obstacle. We can do the same thing with an RC car. So we use the same algorithm. RC car is put in front of obstacles, in this case a cone. Has four starting positions. In every iteration, we'll have five rollouts from each starting position. When it does a rollout, this is what happens underneath. It considers many possible sequences of actions. For each one of them, computes the probability of collision based on the neural net's predictions, looks at the variance on that, based on that, chooses one, executes, and repeats. And actually, it also replans during those executions. It does a model predictive control approach to rather than just open loop rolling things out. This is the training. And this is the final policy. You can also deploy this in other environments. So it's trained here to try to avoid a cone, and it's quite good at that. And if you look at training time, our approach allows to have lower speed collisions than if you ignore uncertainty about the neural net's predictions. In the last couple of minutes I have, I want to tell you about another project we've been working on. This is a pure application project, but I think it's a really interesting application. What we're looking at here is working with NASA on colonizing space, I guess, but a very small part of that, which is how to reliably land on Mars or the moon. Well, turns out that impact can be pretty high, and you want structures that can withstand large impact. You can use some kind of airbags and so forth, but this is a structure they've designed called a tensegrity robot, which consists of bars and cables. You can squash this down to a very small volume, completely planar, and then it'll expand when you give it space. And it can then, on impact, compress, burn some energy that way without damaging itself. The challenge here is to actually make this thing roll. So NASA's been trying for a long time to get this thing to roll reliably. What they've been able to do with hard-coded policies is to essentially you pull the cables, which shortens some edges, which shifts the center of gravity, which then makes it tumble on the next face, and that's how this works. And so with hard-coded policy, we're able to do one tumble, and then something hard-coded that relaxes the whole thing again, puts it in back nice in a relaxed state, and then it goes again. The question is, can we get this thing to roll continuously, learn to roll continuously? For this one, we worked in simulation, did all the training in simulation, taking into account what people told us about where the simulator is reliable, not reliable, shaping the reward to avoid parts of the space where people say you don't want to be. For example, when you put things under very high tension, that's a bad situation to be in. So that gets bad rewards, so we stay away from those situations. Then we rolled it out on the real robot, and actually worked. So here's the real robot in action. It's rolling from face to face. This is real time. This is at NASA Ames in Mountain View. And this actually works quite reliably on flat surfaces so far, and we're looking at extending this to more complicated surfaces. So in the beginning, I've told you that reinforcement learning is a hard problem. There are some solutions that can do pretty well, but the sample complexity tends to be very high. I think here are four directions that still require a lot of future work to actually resolve this, maybe. One stab at safety. There's a lot of other problems in safety that I didn't touch upon. Maybe I'll say something on the last slide there. But there are a few ways that we've made progress on this. If you want to try some things yourself, almost everything I presented to you here is coded into RL Lab. It's a deep reinforcement learning library that you can use for anything you want, very permissive license, commercial, non-commercial. You can use the code. You can contribute to it if you can. That's great. It also has interfaces to the OpenAI gym environments and universe environments. What are some of the remaining frontiers that we're pushing now? Aside from sample complexity and safety, shared and transfer learning, everything I've shown to you has been one robot learning one skill, and then when the robot needs to learn a new skill, learning starts from scratch. That's a very slow way of learning. You want to transfer skill from one robot to another, and also from one skill to another to allow for quicker learning. None of the things I showed you use memory, but in practice, a robot should use memory. When it sees something in this direction and turns around, it should realize that what was there is likely still there. That requires memory. What that actually means in reinforcement learning is it has an inner loop inside that feedback loop. The RNNs for RL squared use a little bit of that, but other than that, very few architectures use memory. Another reason to use memory is for planning. Everything I've shown to you tends to come down to relatively short horizon skills. Maybe 100 time steps, maybe sometimes 1,000 time steps. But a human, on a day, if you think about, let's say, making decisions at 10 hertz, would be many, many more time steps, let's say 24 times 60, 60 times 10. It's hundreds of thousands of time steps. We don't know yet how to do reinforcement learning when the horizon is that long. It will probably require a hierarchy, not clear how to do it, but that will be needed. Grounding language, I think there's a big opportunity here now that skills can be learned to tie the skills to language, to understand in words what the skill is that was being learned. One way to do this would be don't just use a reward function as a signal for learning, but also have a language description that describes the reward function and somehow use that to learn more quickly, but many other things could be tried. A big challenge that we're trying to address in the Center for Human Compatible AI at Berkeley is the value alignment problem. The problem here is looking a little further ahead, essentially saying, let's assume we build an AI. And let's assume that, indeed, we build an AI. And now that AI, since it's a real AI, it's as smart as us, most likely next day is going to be smarter than us because it doesn't have the same kind of resource constraints as we have. Our head is limited. But the AI could maybe take over all computers and have a lot more resources for compute. How do we make sure when we build that this system will actually act in our favor rather than in our disfavor? The kind of most visible precedents are humans. Humans are the smartest, seemingly, on Earth, and they dominate Earth, and all other creatures seem to live a secondary life to humans and are at our mercy largely. Unfortunately, so it's not that we want that per se, but that's how things have played out. So the question here is, can we avoid this? Once there's something smarter than us, can we avoid being at that system's mercy and live good lives that we want to live? The value alignment problem specifically is the problem of understanding what humans care about. So if you, let's say you have a really good reinforcement learner, really, really good, and now you ask it to make a cup of coffee for you in the morning, and that's all you ask for, and now maybe your friend, your roommate wants a cup of coffee today, if that is a good reinforcement learner, they will safeguard the coffee machine from your roommate. Why? Because there's always a small chance that we'll break it. And that will reduce the expected reward of getting you coffee in the morning. OK, you say, well, maybe I need to amend my reward function and say, well, there's also some reward for letting my roommate have coffee. But this thing just keeps going on and on and on. There will always be something you did not anticipate. And so what you really want is a system that can somehow understand what we care about from observing us, rather than needing to have everything spelled out, because we're bound to make mistakes when we do this. I think one real interesting thing as a roboticist that I've found to happen over the past few years is that with the techniques that we're converging on to that are very heavily learning-based, actually, you can work in many application domains at the same time. Whether you want to do manipulation, locomotion, autonomous driving, or autonomous flight, you can think about the same problems. You can think about sample complexity of reinforcement learning, safety, grounding language to command robots, and so forth, and it'll apply to all of them, which I think is pretty exciting. Thank you. Pedro.
So how do you propose to do transfer learning?
Question was, how do you propose to do transfer learning? Rather than giving a proposal, let me highlight a few lines of work that I think have been very promising. One is not exactly transfer, but related. There are two papers that came out of DeepMind in November, where they looked at first-person maze navigation, and they introduced auxiliary losses related to predicting depth and related to optimizing other rewards. Because queue learning is off policy, you can optimize multiple rewards and different outputs of your neural net. So that was one way to speed up learning. That's not exactly multitask, but it is auxiliary task and real task. Another thing that I think has been very promising is the domain confusion type work, where you learn in simulation. You force it to find a feature representation that's invariant between simulation and real world, and that way transfer quickly onto the real world. One thing that's been very surprising there, I think, is some recent work by Frechte and Sergey Levin on adaptation from simulation to real world for flight. It's a very simple problem. It's just trying to fly into the deepest spot of the image, so it's not full vision. It's finding the deepest spot in the image, but that was trained only in simulation. And by rendering in simulation with multiple different textures, many, many different textures, it learned the essence of where the deepest thing is. Without ever seeing a real image, even when it gets a real image in the future, it knows what to do. So those I think, are pretty exciting. Another direction that we've been pushing is a modular approach. Jacob Andreas at Berkeley was the first one to push this with Dan Klein and Trevor Darrell, where he would say, essentially, for different tasks, you have a task is compositional. In the robotic sense, it would be there would be maybe a robot and an object. And there is a neural net specific to the object, a neural net specific to the robot. And when the task involves both, you bolt them together, and they execute the task together. And this way, you can recombine robots and tasks in various ways to get reasonable. I mean, we've only done this in simulation so far, but in simulation, this is able to recombine pieces and be successful. I think a big part of it that should not be underestimated to make this successful is that you need a lot of tasks to get good coverage such that you can expect transfer to happen. For example, people have tried for a long time to do transfer on Atari games with extremely little success. And when there is success, it ends up being things like, oh, we actually introduced a new Atari game where instead of being Pong black and white, it's now Pong white and black, and look, we have transfer. Which indicates that, yes, these algorithms might be there, they might work, but it requires that there is a strong similarity. And so if you have just have 28 Atari games that are somewhat unrelated, the challenge might be too hard and there might be no signal there. And so that's, I think, where something like Universe could come in. So Universe has thousands of games, and that's a big part of the thinking there. If there's thousands or millions of games, there's a much higher chance that you can transfer than when you have 20 or 30 games.
Yes? So you talk about grounded language here, and when I've seen grounded language dealt with in robotics, it's often as a kind of like last thing that you do, okay, well, now that we can navigate the world, like how do we talk about certain objects? But now that you have this meta learning architecture, right, and you're saying that like there's a lot of space to explore on what kind of meta learning you want to do for learning how to reinforcement learn. Have you considered using language as a means to figure out what kind of thing you should be learning? Because that's what people often do, like, right? Like, when you, like, run faster, you're like, oh, well, raise your knees more or do something like that, right? Whereas it's not really a signal for how well you're doing so much as what you should be trying to learn.
So the question was about grounding language and, I guess, maybe generically speaking, how that might play out. There's some very interesting work that's been done by Dieter's done some of the work, Nick Roy, Stephanie Talix, also I think Luke Zettelmeyer, a couple of other people have looked at grounding language related to, especially to commands. So if a command is given and there's a reward function, understand how they relate to each other. So that's one way to do it, that you understand what it means to be asked to pass a cup or something. Or to navigate to the end of the hallway. A lot of them are in navigation. I think that's really, really interesting. I think a lot of language relates to goals, as you proposed. A lot of it also relates to how to achieve those goals. One way to interpret that is that it relates to reward shaping. So reward shaping is where you give more information about what is not really the reward, but a way to achieve the reward. And so that way, the same formalism might apply. One of the things I'm personally finding most intriguing is to see if language can emerge as a need, as something that's needed to succeed at a task. So for example, let's say I cannot move to the room next door, but there's a glass window, and I can talk to the person next door. I can ask them to do something for me. If initially they don't know what I'm asking, well, then they might not do the right thing because they don't have a language model yet. But maybe over time, I can build up a language model with the person on the other side. They start doing the right thing, and now we can start communicating. And so I think grounding language in how it can lead to action is something that we might be able to start doing now that action learning is starting to work, and that was not possible before. And have it emerge together with motor skills, language skills, and motor skills kind of come up together at the same time. There's a couple of papers along these lines. There's an NYU paper and a DeepMind paper that look at essentially generating one bit or one string that goes from one agent to another agent, and then the other agent is based on that doing the right thing, and they both get rewarded based on what the second agent did. But I think that's just a very initial starting point. I think there is a lot more that can be done than communicating a string. I mean, language is compositional. You can compose words in different ways. None of that work actually composes words. It's just one string per command. And then there's a lot of pragmatics to language. How do you express things that you can express in multiple ways? How do you ask for clarification, which means going back and forth? I think there's a lot of things there that are completely untouched that now that action can be learned, likely could be learned along with action. Emma.
It seems to me that there is very little effort in this community to check for overfitting and do any serious exploration. I mean, it's like there are all these performance graphs going up, and sure, like if you give it more parameters, the more it will be overfit and go up. And whenever there's any kind of cross-validation, it's not clear, is this real cross-validation or is the test set almost the same thing as the training set, and that they're so dense that there's basically no separation between them. So how do you not just play
it? So the question is about, essentially, to which extent is there a train and a test set in these reinforcement learning settings? And I think one extreme answer would be that actually none of this has a test set, in that people run reinforcement learning in an environment, train the policy, and report the final performance. So you might train for locomotion, and then you report performance on locomotion. And the kind of more classical way to think of it would be one Markov decision process is one training example. It's an expensive training example because you've got to run reinforcement learning to train in it, but it's only one. And I think it will be important to start switching away from learning on one at a time to learn on many. And so small steps in that direction are things like a lot of people are starting to report results on, let's say, Atari games where they can tune the hyperparameters only once, or tune the hyperparameters only on 5 or 10 of the games, and then run the same algorithm on the other games and make sure that the algorithm still learns to perform well on other games. So you can't be in the loop on every one of the games to make it succeed.
So that's a fine answer, but I'm not sure it's fair to say that given one MDP, you can actually learn it. Like what we're learning is a small fraction of the states that it makes sense. So for example, if you take walking, like if you train something that gives you a limit cycle starting from some good state, if I now put you on the floor, you probably don't know how to get up. But sure, your test set is never going to see that. Because the way you formulated the MDP is, like, there's some certain initial states, there are certain perturbations that you're considering, and others that are not. There are certain resetting things. So I think there is overfitting, not just to which MDP you're choosing, but to the specifics of how you chose to execute that.
You're saying there is also overfitting to the initial state distribution.
And to the specific perturbations that you consider, and the fact that they may be very small and they're white noise, which means that effectively they average out and they're not real.
Yeah, so I think one way to think of it is that what this is giving is a measurement. It's giving you a measurement of if your initial distribution is this wide, then this algorithm can learn within, let's say, 10 hours of learning to control the system. And it's absolutely true that it doesn't give you a measurement about completely different initial states. Maybe it's likely if the distribution is similar coverage, that also it would take 10 hours to do it, but it might be that certain initial states are a lot harder than others. In fact, I don't have safety on this slide here, but I think if you think about safety, let's say you think about self-driving cars. Humans will get into a deadly accident every 3 million miles or something, so it's, it takes a long time. So let's assume you only want to get into a self-driving car once it's better than a human driver. And maybe you say, I'm better than the average human driver. So you want only a self-driving car once it's better than once every 6 million miles. That means that once a self-driving car gets into an accident every, let's say, million miles, you're still not happy with it. But the rate at which it's going to collect data that's interesting data is going to be extremely bad. It's almost never going to encounter anything interesting if all it does is try to drive well. And I think that relates a little bit to your question is, can we have the systems somehow tell us which part of the space they're not good at yet, and where the challenges are that are still remaining? And one way to do it is just say, okay, now we know the system's not that great. The next step would be how to force the system into those states and learn from those states to become better. So if it's really good at starting from standing up and running, but it knows that once every 6 million miles of running it's going to fall over, maybe it should deliberately fall over and try to see if it can get back up and learn that. And none of the current systems really try to do any of that. I think the thing that comes the closest is things like AlphaGo, where you have an explicit opponent, and that opponent is really poking at you and finding the weaknesses in your policy and forcing you to fix them. Yes?
So earlier you talked about sort of enforcing an internal abstraction, like telling the agent to learn to make a map so that it could then use that map. Do you know of any successful work on sort of generally rewarding coming up with useful internal representations for reinforcement learners, where you don't specify, I want a map, but you specify, come up with some internal representation and then use that, rather than just like just giving the end reward, also rewarding sort of creative abstractions internally?
So the question is how to encourage more abstractions that are relevant to be formed internally. And so one example that I showed was the validation networks with the maps. Validation networks themselves are an example because they force images to be reshaped by the neural net into state information. The embed to control is an example. All the examples I've seen, and then the common filter slide had a few examples. All the examples I've seen have largely been saying, I know the shape of the state space that I'm going to be working in, hence I know what kind of calculation will happen there, and I'm going to force things into that. Some exceptions are things like the DeepMind result on predicting depth. They ran an experiment where they say, instead of just predicting the Q values, let's also predict depth from the same neural net. It learned more quickly that way, suggesting that whatever that signal was providing it with allows it to learn more quickly. You could then ask the question, did it learn more quickly because it now has available depth? So then they just fed in depth from the start as an extra input, depth map and regular image, and that did not help nearly as much. And so that's an interesting case where it seems that the features you care about relate to the RGB image in this case, and to learn those features more quickly, depth was a great signal, but it was only helpful to learn the features. It wasn't helpful in its own right to do better. So that's an example where there was something along those lines. I think the modular networks go in this direction too. When you say I'm going to recompose based on task and robot and put them together, because then you're also forcing there to be an interface that's essentially invariant to the robot that you'll be working with. You extract things from the task that are relevant for any robot and also sufficient information for any robot to then act on. There might be more, but I think it's very interesting. I think in general, just the reward signal is too sparse to count on to learn quickly, and some other signal has to come in.
You rarely see robotics works comparing very well because I mean, it's just very hard to judge how well the algorithm's actually doing since there's no hard benchmarks.
Yeah, so a lot of fields have good benchmarks like computer vision. You had Caltech 101, then Pascal VOC, then ImageNet, and then now all the kind of captioning and so forth. In robotics, there aren't any completely equivalent benchmarks to that that are definitely not as widely adopted by the community, which is a little bit of a pity because it makes it very easy when there's such a benchmark to understand when something is doing better than what was possible before. I think the simulators are helping us though. Mujoko environments, you can have the same environment. You can set up the exact same environment in Mujoko and then have the same initial state distribution and see how fast you learn. So that was the incentive behind setting up OpenAI Gym, was to provide a set of environments, both physics simulation, mostly Mujoko, and then also some games such that people can compare. On the Atari games, people do compare. The slightly tricky part there is that DeepMind throws a lot of compute resources at their runs, and so they run for a really, really long time, and with many, many hyperparameters, which makes it a little tricky to get equally good performance if you don't have an enormous budget to do the same thing. But I think the Mujoka environments don't require nearly as much hyperparameter sweeping and duration of training. And there, it should be possible to compare pretty well. For real robots, it's hard. It's always different. That's a pity, because the real robot settings are always much harder than simulated ones. They're almost always much harder. And it's not clear how to compare one robot to another one all that straightforwardly.
In most of the experiments that you showed, they involve sort of very high dimensional inputs like vision. So where do you think deep learning is helping you the most? Is it on the perception side or the credit assignment side? And could deep learning actually be helping with one and hurting you with the other?
Okay, so where might the deep architectures help the most is the question, right? Clearly in perception, nobody knows how to do perception at any comparable level without deep learning, so no way around it there. On the control side, the way I tend to think of it is that if you think of rectified linear unit networks, effectively what you're doing is you're partitioning the space. And you're partitioning the space into regions where you have different linear controllers in each partition of the space, and very gradual transitions along one not axis aligned coordinate at a time when you go from partition to partition. So a lot of sharing between the linear controllers across the space. So it's like building hybrid control systems, except that it's a much more gradual transition between them, and it's learned. And that, to me, when we started doing this, was the main motivation to believe that this would work well, because linear control locally works really, really well in many, many situations. And so I think the notion that you can learn the combination of linear controllers with this kind of architecture is very helpful, and I believe that actually makes a difference. How deep it needs to be to get good partitions, it's not so clear. A lot of the control networks are not nearly as deep as the vision networks. A lot of the vision networks are quite deep, like tens of layers. A lot of the control networks only have a handful of layers, or only three or four layers even, to do the control part. I will add to that, I think the real missing piece, though, here is that in vision, the convolutional layers tend to get small coverage in the beginning and expand over time because of the way they're laid out. The influence initially is just from the local pixels, but it spreads out as you get deeper and deeper in the network. This is not happening for these control networks because there's no temporal aspect in how they're typically set up. And so I think a big question would be to set up something similar that spans over time and does the right thing over time and somehow does better than something that's only looking one time slice per decision. But trajectory optimization would be one way to do it. You could build it into the neural net even if you want.
Please join me in thanking Pieter Abbeel once again.